Okay.
Well, Barb, here we are. The date is 1/25/93, and we're going to do a bit of Sylvan Beach history, and I couldn't think of a better person to ask than you.
Well,
you certainly have a whole lot to say and a whole lot of good things that I think we can look at. I guess the first question would be, what were your first memories of Sylvan Beach?
Well, Joe, this will be, of course, personal memories. There will be other families that will have memories of very similar things and events, but I'm sure each family has its own perspective on something, and I'm not going to go into old things that I really don't remember myself. They'll get that from another generation, and the same with the younger people. They're going to have their memories. The thing I seem to recall the earliest was spending days down at the Big Lake Michigan beach. Seemed that we all spent most all day down there, and as a family. The fathers were there. They weren't necessarily off playing golf or somewhere else, but we were all together in groups of whoever lived kind of along the top of the hill at that point. There'd be the Naveens and the Middletons and the Myers, whoever lived along the top of the hill there where my grandparents, the Vandeventers, lived. And I remember the path. There were not very many wooden steps down to the beach. When I was growing up, there was a zigzag path that John Naveen and Uncle Myers, we called him, maintained every spring. They would rake it out and see that there was a pole, something that you could hang onto as you spun back and forth, till you got down to the shore. And for a while, I guess there were some wooden steps out over the top dune, and there was a big wooden box where we could put the beach toys and inner tubes and beach robes, so that the mothers didn't have to carry them up and down. However, the beach robes didn't work, or beach towels didn't work too well, because they never dried out. They stayed wet and they got moldy. And speaking of wet, and being very young and spending time on the big beach, we had woolen swimsuits. They also never dried out, and did they ever itch? Oh, it was terrible. You just
woolen
swimsuits. They never seemed to dry out.
Well, why were they wool?
Because they didn't have latex, or they didn't make swimsuits of cotton in those days in the 1930, if I was born in 26, so around the late 20s and early 30s, all swimsuits were wool.
I'll be darned.
So, but anyway, my family spent, before my folks purchased the large house on the hill from the Adams, spent some time at the Vandeventer house or at the McDowell house, their two parents. And of course, I remember my grandfather Vandeventer. He had a green wooden swing out in the front of his house. It was one of those ones that was on a tripod, kind of, and you could get in, went in, and there was two seats, and it went like this.
Yeah.
And he had what he called the Marshmallow Club. He sent to Chicago, or brought from Chicago, huge tins, white tin of marshmallows. And all the little kids would go over after dinner, and you were allowed two. But you got two marshmallows, so.
Can you tell us approximately what year that was?
Well, it ran on for quite a few years. I'd say it was sometime between, I would have been between maybe 5 and 10, something in there, so it would have been 1930 to 1935, I'm guessing.
Yeah.
But those were the kind of things I remember. I also remember on a rainy day, we were allowed to go down to Grandma Lockwood's house to read. She had collected all the colored comics for years and years, the funny papers, we called them. And that's the house that's now Dort's.
Okay.
So we could go to Grandma Lockwood's only on a rainy day and just sit there and spend hours and hours looking through all the old funny papers. And that was such fun.
Why did she save the old funny papers?
I don't know how she started to ever do that, but it was just a wonderful thing to do, because it really was, it's great, and it still is. I started for a while, but I didn't have a place to store them.
Yeah.
But it was fun to go back to the early Orphan Annies and some of the classics.
Yes. And there was no TV then.
Oh, heavens no.
That was your method of having fun.
Little, kind of simple pleasure things.
Yeah.
Sunday nights, as we got a little older, the Naveen family, they weren't allowed to go to movies or out to anything social. So Grandfather Naveen in the big old crazy house, all the kids could come down. And again, he bought the Sunday papers from three or four Grand Rapids, Chicago, Muskegon. They always had a big, huge bowl of popcorn and apples, and all the kids would go over there Sunday, and because they couldn't go out, so the rest of us didn't either.
He's a very strict man.
Well, he was. If you recall, he was instrumental in the church, and you weren't supposed to play tennis or do anything noisy during the church service and things like that. But
Well, you know, there was an article in the newspaper last fall, Barb, and you were featured in it, as a matter of fact, as the unofficial historian of Sylvan Beach.
I think I just...
should be official.
Oh, I'm just the repository for all the books and pictures and information that anybody has, I think, and I'm glad to do it. I think it's fun, and I've always been interested in it. I think I can practically walk the whole beach and give you a little story about every family as you go along, some that I only heard from long before I was born, but that were all kind of interesting.
Okay. Can you tell us what brought your grandfather or father here? Can you tell us why or what happened?
Yes, I have that in my little cryptie here somewhere. I guess the land, well, originally... It's in that history I think I gave you. Originally, this area was mostly used by the Whitehall Montague people. It was a picnic area. They would come down by launch and bring a picnic and have a nice Sunday, Saturday or Sunday. There was a man, I can't recall his name right now, that purchased some land on the White Lake side from the probably the logging companies after they'd taken out the white pines and were so surprised there was no more wood and moved north. So he built about where I think where Rickers and Bitters cottages on the White Lake side a pavilion, a dance platform, and he also sunk a well because before the people had to bring water. He provided, although the people liked the Michigan beach better. It was more pleasant than just along the White Lake shore. So they would traipse through the path, which was just a path where the road is now. And he had built some steps to go down also to the Michigan beach. So people had a very pleasant weekend. Well, I guess my grandfather came up visiting the Covels, who he knew from somewhere, and to hunt and fish, and he loved the area. And the people began to think, well, instead of just a day's picnic, it would be nice to make it a little more permanent. So some of them built little shack things, and there were some little buildings, I guess, left from the lumbering companies. Or they brought tents and left them here during the summer and would come for longer periods than just the weekend. So, it just became more and more that the little shacks became a little more cottagey, a little more sophisticated or whatever, until at the time the four gentlemen that decided that this would be a wonderful place for result and bought the land from the, I believe it was the Staples and the Covels, who sold the peninsula part that we know as Sylvan Beach, with the exception of five properties that they retained for themselves, and four of those are still held in, I think it's called fee simple, or they own their own land. They're not part of the association. Excuse me.
Just a little sideline here. I just recall, didn't the Covels own where the Hartses are now?
Yeah, it was one of them.
Okay, yeah.
Nancy Books.
Okay, yeah.
Hartses, the Naveen. And next door, what's now Hunkler's. Those are the four. The other one was the Vandeventer Cottage that when my parents sold it to the Goulds, part of the stipulation was that they would come into the association, which they did.
Okay.
So there's just four that are not now. Okay. when we were lucky to be here all summer long, and as most of the people were in those days, the young people didn't have to have jobs really, and most everybody was here all of July and August. And of course we were in Chicago, and it was a long drive from Chicago. It took us all day.
About 8 hours
or so? Oh, at least. It took us all day, and we would stop in Benton Harbor for lunch at the Whitcomb Hotel, which is no longer there, and then arrive. We also came up, usually spring vacation, and did a lot of raking, because when I was here, you did your own raking. There was no, we had caretakers, but that was not part of their duties, yeah.
What type of car? Do you remember any of the cars?
Some kind of a little old Ford, not a Model T. It wasn't quite that early enough, but it was in the 30s, and then except for a 2-week vacation, my father took the train back and forth from Chicago, the old Pier Marquette, I think, and left. Before that the boat, but that was before my time. It left Chicago Friday night, and they arrived here overnight at 8 in the morning or something in Muskegon, and then they have to leave Sunday evening, and we're back in Chicago Monday morning. Well, then another early thing, as I say, the swimming was the thing we loved the best, and my two sisters, Nancy and Judy, we obviously had no fear of the water. We could swim before we could. We were always jumping off the dive before I could walk. Almost, my folks were very fine swimmers, and always took us to the water. And we used to jump off the diving board at the arcade before we could really swim. But we would jump off into the water, and my father would be underneath hauling us out. And one time we got going a little too fast, and he had three little girls all sinking.
But that was when the arcade was still down.
Oh yes, that was for there a long time from when I was little.
Do you know approximately when the arcade was built and when it was torn down?
No, I'm sure that somewhere in the records of Sylvan that would be could be found. But we used to go did a lot of silly things for nowadays. But we always went swimming when it was a rainstorm. Now they say never, you could be electrocuted, whatever, but we always wore bathing caps. Why we wore a bathing cap to go swimming in the rain, I don't know.
Yeah, it doesn't make it.
But we always seemed to do that, which was fun. And there was the ice man that came with blocks of ice for your ice boxes, and we'd chip off pieces and suck on them, no matter how dirty they were.
And that was the ice too that was taken out of the lake.
That was the ice.
The winter time.
Yes, it was stored down in the ice house, which of course burned too. I guess didn't it at one time, or was it moved?
That's cellars now.
Oh, that's
garage.
That's right. Yeah. But let's see. Of course, I remember my dad, who was a big man, and he always had the perennial cigar or ever-present cigar in his mouth, which everyone remembers. He loved the beach, and he had a big blue terry cloth robe that he was always going up and down and back and forth in, and
carrying the cigar.
Yeah, well,
the
cigar was usually in his mouth.
Sounds like quite a character.
Well, he was, and then on my mother's side, my grandmother, everyone knew her as Mimi McDowell, her son Bob, mother's brother, and she was a wonderful cook. She could pastries, just her pies and cakes and cookies, and she made a white divinity fudge that she would just beat and beat and beat until it was just, oh, so good.
It was perfect.
But, she had the old wood-burning stove, great big one in the kitchen, and in the mornings we made our toast by putting it on a log fork and taking out the black round thing and holding the toast into the fire until it got crispy. But it had a good taste.
Oh, it sounds like it.
I'm just wondering how many of my group of little people remember Annie V. Downing in her morning reading class.
I certainly haven't heard of it.
Well, it was mostly these little girls that we went around. I think John Howell was part of it, but it was the Devines and the Howell group, Lucy and Mary Howell and Kathy Redmond, Nancy, Judy, and myself. But Annie V. was Vera Middleton Downing, and they were in the cottage that's now Peggy Dilly's, and I think it was twice a week at 11 o'clock, anybody who wished could gather on her front porch, and she would read to us the great classics and wonderful books, some adventure stories, And it was always the privilege. She would sit at one end of this big green glider, and she had a little Cocker Spaniel named Mac. So it was always who got to sit next to Mac and Auntie V. But it was a wonderful way to start.
Certainly.
To start in.
Made it a magical summer.
Oh, it did. I mean, you're all, and when you're all together, and that went on for quite a few years until we were all almost too old and got into other interests.
Why did she do that?
I don't really know how it started. Whether it was her own, did it for her own children first, who were a little older than this group, and they weren't part of it. She might have done it for them beforehand, or what? But she had a wonderful reading voice, so it was just fascinating. Let's see. Also, our family were very close to the Sidonis over at in Montague, and they would come over about once every 2 weeks and have dinner with either my folks or my grandparents. And afterwards, one of the three of us girls usually always got to go back to the Valley of the Pines for overnight. And I remember they had a little Ford coupe with a rumble seat. And we would pretend that the folks didn't know we were going. Whoever was chosen, whether it was Nancy or Judy or myself, would hide in the rumble seat, and then just as they were pulling down the hill, pop up and say, you know, you don't know it, but I'm going. of course, they knew perfectly well.
Yeah.
But we had wonderful experiences over at the Sidonis, and they were very, very good friends.
Well, you hit on a very important topic on the history of White Lake, which is the Sidonis. Do you remember the elder, Mr. Sidoni, the one that was the entertainer? And
very
the
well.
Can you tell us something?
Very
about
well.
Or as much as you can tell.
Well, again, we were great for uncle and aunt designations for people, and I always called them Uncle Joe and Aunt Lillian. And I remember him very well. He was a kind, wonderful man. He was self-educated, but he was certainly had a brilliant brain. And he was a semi-inventor. He had, I believe, the laser beam. Even when I was a kid, he called it the black light, up in his electrical shop. And there was little shops, little areas of over at the valley, that one was electrical work and one was tools. And there was a barn out and back, and they had the hired man, Charlie Abel. And he had one finger was gone, and I can remember being real little, and he would say that the cow bit it off or something, and we would just sit there with the big...
Scared to death.
And of course, Jack DeFraga and Meredith. I can't remember Meredith's last name, who was kind of Uncle Joe's more or less secretary, who later went on to be a brilliant out to California to the think tanks. And we never knew. We just thought he was a local, somebody that was just a helper. But I think Uncle Joe was also very religious, and he may have prophesied. Done prophecies, but to me most of his things were common sense, things that you almost could, anybody could, if they thought about it, could really say. But he really tried to show how religion and science could coexist, and it wasn't all evolution or all science, all the Bible. It could come together.
They complemented each other.
Yes, and he had quite a few experiments that. That proved this. They were scientific experiments, but he made them into a religious
connotation.
Kind of, yeah. You know the trick nowadays, where you have the pool balls on strings hanging in a row, and if you pull one off and let it hit the others, one will pop off of the other. I'm not a scientist. I don't know what kind of energy that's called, but something transfers kinetic energy. And he had the center ball, which was the black one, was labeled Jesus. And then the ones on each side were the disciples, and they were labeled just like an 8-ball or a 10-ball.
Probably Judas was the 8-ball.
could be. I don't remember. He may not have even been in there. But if you took two disciples off and let them fall back, then two popped off the other end. It was quite an interesting way of presenting things.
Yes. Was this in that brick building over there in the bay that we now see?
Now, if I'm correct, that was built much later as a boathouse, I think, originally. But during the war, World War II, it was kind of a laboratory. Joe and Arthur had a government contract to do packaging, like pounds of butter sizes, and they manufactured packaging. Then it was kind of converted to a couple of apartments, and I think it still may be used for that, or it may be empty now. I don't know. Okay. I don't think he didn't. As far as I know, Joe never had any of his lab work or his scientific things there. Okay. It was mostly up at the valley. There was a wonderful little chapel that was a separate building, completely lined in pine boughs, and I think that's why they became the Valley of the Pines. Why it never burned, I'll never know. It was, but oh, the smell! When you went in, you can imagine the whole little room was just thick pine boughs. But they were a wonderful, interesting family. And of course, Joe and Arthur did a lot of things here at the beach. They usually worked the lights in the Jinx during those earlier times, and built wonderful stage sets. They had some kind of a famous collapsing stair that the gals had this. I know they had some kind of a wonderful dance number that they had to climb up and down the stairs, and then the stair flattened out and they all slid down. It was almost like a Busley Berkeley kind of a production.
Oh, that's excellent. you've hit on some things that I never knew about Mr. Sidoni. You said that you never really saw too much of the parapsychology or mystical experiences.
I didn't. He was just a good down-to-earth. Of course, he loved the pomp and ceremony of dressing up as the sheriff, and he wore the puttees, you know, and the like a Mountie hat.
Oh, you're kidding. And he was sheriff?
He was sheriff over in that area for a while.
So he really got off on being sheriff?
He kind of liked that. Well, it was very... it was quite stirring, you know. He cut quite a figure.
Yeah.
And he has a little goatee. And
so you don't remember too much of the, or you're saying that actually there wasn't that much of the mystical or parapsychology?
Not that I was conscious of.
Which you would be the one, I'm certainly.
Well, not necessarily, but we did see quite a bit of them. And as I say, he was just awfully, awfully kind. And although we weren't to intrude on his, when he was writing or and he had another separate building that was up the hill a little bit where he did his, kind of like an office where he did his writing. But
did you seek him out with other kids at that time or just go?
No, it was strictly our family.
Or your family.
Because, no, it wasn't open house in any way. You were invited, if that was it.
Okay, well, that's fascinating.
At least that's my remembrances of this.
When did he die?
I don't remember.
Not sure. Okay.
I don't remember, and I know Lillian not too long afterwards. Of course, both Joe and Arthur are living, although I understand that Joe isn't too well right now.
It's a shame.
Well,
maybe we can get in touch with him at some point.
Well, shall I go on? I've got one little interesting thing that I recall very vividly of Homer Hartz, and again, Uncle Homer, we always called him, and Auntie Bert. But one summer, the Lake Michigan was very pitted with, the water had gotten holes, so that as you played out in the water, if you stepped off of one of the, kind of like a little sandbar, you were suddenly way over your head. And I had gotten a little further to the right than where my folks were, I guess, and I stepped off of one of these little sand cliffs and was really struggling to, I couldn't touch, and I couldn't get to the higher sand again, and I don't think I was going to drown, but I might have. Pretty panicky, and Uncle Homer saw me, and he dove right in and pulled me out. So
saved by
Homer Hartz. Well, how about the hotel? Remember the big?
I was going to get to you.
Big hotel, great, huge, what, 5-story wooden building, terrible fire trap.
Was it?
Oh, well, that's of course.
Yes, we are.
But we used to go over there for dinner during World War II quite often because meat was obtainable. I don't know how they managed, but of course, for meat you had to have your food stamps or your coupons, whatever. But we could get meat. We used to have dinner there. We never stayed there personally, but many of the people up here stayed at the hotel before they purchased cottages, mainly the Chittendens that I can remember.
Okay. How many people did the hotel hold, do you think? How many rooms?
Again, that was a little before my time. I'm sure somebody like Harriet or Mother would know that better than I. And as I say, well, the Jinx we've talked about, or have we?
No, we haven't.
Well, I guess you and I were talking before. Well, let's see. I guess I'll repeat then what I was telling you.
Said it was great.
And again, I could sometimes Bun's memory isn't perfect. So if anyone has corrections to make on these things that I'm remembering, don't or feel free. I certainly could be wrong, but I went over to Lorna Adams one time and started asking some questions about how it all started, and she said that one summer, and we're not real sure of the date, but the three Mead girls, that would be Annie Burt and Alice Walker and something Cummings, I can't think of her name, those three sisters, and Bess Middleton, which was Peggy Dilly's mother, and one or two other of the young ladies, there wasn't much to do. They were kind of bored, and Frank had been putting on plays at University of Chicago and writing songs and writing the lyrics. Will Huff and Joe Howard wrote the music.
Okay.
And so they asked him if he'd whip them up a little play that they could put on, which he did. So, and then it started from then on. And then every summer, that was became one of the things for the young people to do, was to put on a play. And of course, then it's not like it is now. Then it was strictly older, almost adult.
Okay.
No.
In the 20s, generally.
Yeah. Yes. Or well, anywhere I'd say from 15 or 16 up, except for maybe one or two. If an act required a younger person, but it wasn't all.
It wasn't
these,
what it is now.
It wasn't all the little ones that are
baby
here.
Baby factory here.
babysitting. But it became quite professional then after a while. And Frank kind of eventually, after a couple of years, took it over as director, and it was all original music and words and skits.
Are there any songs that you can remember that came out?
By the time I got into it, he was no longer involved.
Mm-hmm.
Mother would know.
Mm-hmm. How about, I wonder if Gangway for the Sylvan Beach Gang was...
I'm not sure whether that was one of his or not.
It was Mountain Greenery, wasn't it?
It was to the tune of Mountain Greenery.
Did he write that game?
He could have done... I don't think he wrote Mountain Greenery. I know he didn't, but he might have written the words to it.
Okay.
Adapted the...
So the first year of the Jinxton was 1909?
I think that's what I said from that other...
Would you like that other paper?
No, I think I can pretty much remember. But the costumes came from Chicago, New York. The Sinonis built sets, did sophisticated lighting for those days.
What did they have for a band? Or an orchestra?
Okay. The time that... As I say, this was, I wasn't going to go back this far, but there were three young men from, were they University of Chicago or Michigan, that came up here for all summer long. They were musicians, so they had a little combo. And they lived at the Wob Club. One of them was Orm Lyman, if I recall, and he still comes back once a summer and sees Mother. Lives up north. They lived there, and they played, there was Saturday night dances and Wednesday night dances, and they played for the Jinx.
Okay, so they were mainly there to play for the dances?
Dances and parties, if you wanted them, but they were part of the gang, part of the young people.
What year was that, do you think?
Again, you're going to have to get some of those things from Mom, but they had the music there, they had the little trio. For rehearsals, and of course they spend a lot more time on it than they do now. They whip it together in 2 weeks.
Yeah.
They usually spent a good bit of the summer, and the costumes. Some were sent away, but the people were more involved. The mothers made a great many of the costumes. They would have sewing sprees and make a lot of the costumes.
Which is something you're very good at. I know that. You're very good.
That's my pleasure. But it kind of, I guess the people grew up and there were other interests, and so there were. I believe it was out of production from about between 1926 till about 1938. There was about 12, 13 years that there wasn't any Jinx. I don't think. Again, this is where if somebody knows for sure, please. But I've always loved any kind of play acting, and I remember writing. some fairy tales and got the little group of girls together, and we had the first just adapting fairy tales. We had it over on Naveen's porch. Then a couple years later, we did some more and got costumes out of the attic and put on Bluebeard, and we had it down at the WOB Club. And it was quite a success. In fact, the gals that were in that still remember their lines. And Kathy Redmond, Lucy Children,
yes.
Margie and Ann Naveen, Nancy Van was Bluebeard. And
was this considered a jinx?
Not really. It would not have been an official jinx, I don't think. Except
certainly would have to be called that.
But I think we might have called it that, or just
done it in the same tradition.
In the same idea, and I think we charged it. 5 cents for children and 10 cents for adults, and we made $13.50, and gave it to the Red Cross. And we got our names in the paper for that.
Wonderful! What paper was it?
Oh, I think it was the Whitehall Forum or something.
Do you remember what years those were? Would have to be about.
Well,
35.
About a little later, a little about 38 or 9 after.
Okay.
Something around in there, and Ellen and I did. We talked about. Then later on, the association brought in not professionals but paid people to supervise the jinx and to run it. Among them were Monty Montgomery, now Terry Berry, and a woman called Elliot, I believe, and they lived at the WOB Club, and then it kind of evolved to a willing teenager, or sometimes some couples did it. I recall the Leichners and. I think possibly the Schaefers did it at one time together. Not real sure about that. And of course, more and more younger people were brought in to the jinx. So we all know what it is now,
right?
Which is quite a show. And there's certainly people that only come in August just for that reason.
Exactly. Can you tell us some more about the people who lived in the WOB Club from the point of view of in the later years? For instance, I can remember the 50s when that place was just kind of open and the last person who ran it, just left it, would live there. Were these people generally just people who worked for the resort during the summer?
As far as I know, and I don't recall, that was the 50s were when I was not up here for any length of time. I had 4 small children and we only had a week's or 2 weeks vacation, lived in Denver, and it was hard to get here. So those were the years that I didn't have all the as many contacts as I did before or later on.
Okay, so generally then the people would be like in the 40s, as you remember them, were just people that
somebody paid, like our activities chairman, is in fact that's what they were called, if I believe.
Yeah,
and also we would have a special lifeguard. Those people didn't do that, or a tennis person. In fact, I don't remember a tennis person in those days.
No, but
there was the lifeguard, and of course there was the Annette Richards. My goodness, that name came out. She was a lady that taught swimming when I was really little, and I think acted as a lifeguard in the morning hours. We all took swimming lessons from her.
We all took swimming. That seems to have happened a lot here during the summer.
And then she would put on a water show. Too, we all would
synchronized or something.
Oh well, sometimes we had, as I said, we always wore bathing suits. I remember rubber flowers. You want to stop for a second?
Oh, sure.
I need get a cleaner.
Exact moment the tape came to an end. That'll be
well. All right.
So I got another tape in there.